What's Wrong with Congress? This is from Collier's Weekly, 1933, January the 28th. The fundamental lack of Congress is informed intelligence. Congress must, under the Constitution, pass on matters which, under its present organization, it is incapable of understanding without great delay. 531 men, in the very nature of things, can't think quickly or act expeditiously. Congress, furthermore, has neglected to use the tools and the devices which would enable it to inform its members accurately and so lay the basis of swift and intelligent action. This is what is wrong with Congress. A Mussolini, a Stalin, or any well-entrenched dictator can act instantly and compel obedience. If he is a wise dictator, he can employ scholars and experts to gather his facts and formulate his policies. Napoleon knew the trick. So much of what he ordered done remains, including the famous Code Napoleon. Congress has no dictators and a few leaders. The will or the mind of no individual prevails. There are no more Tom Reeds or Joe Cannons to regiment the House. No Aldrich dominates the Senate. Instead of the tough-minded old reactionaries of a past generation, coteries and groups rule. Whatever is done is a compromise. The old order won't return. The Speaker's czars belong to a gone generation. In business, too, the ancient rule of the iron men has vanished. Modern problems call for new methods. Congress lags because it has not equipped itself to operate successfully in this new age. Take, for example, prohibition and beer, upon which surprisingly early votes were obtained. The necessity for wise action was obvious enough. William D. Mitchell, Attorney General, a modest and conservative lawyer, had plainly pointed out the facts when, in his annual report, he said, "If any changes are to be made in our national system of prohibition, two things are obvious. First, the changes, if any, should be made as quickly as possible. And second, changes should be made through the amendment of the substantive law, and not by leaving laws on the statute books and scuttling them by refusal to appropriate money for their enforcement." Sounder advice could not have been given by legal counsel. It was not taken, not because individual congressmen and senators opposed quick action, but because Congress as a body is incapable of quick action. Day after day, congressmen debated decimal points in the alcoholic content of non-intoxicating beer. Public irritation grew, not because the beer bill was discussed, but because tedious talk prevented action on other equally important matters. Unquestionably, Congress had to set its seal upon any definition of non-intoxicating beer, which is to be accepted as legal. Yet the question itself is technical. The average congressman and senator is no more capable of forming a reasonable opinion on this subject than he is of deciding when an operation should be made in a surgical case. Physiologists and no one else are qualified to measure the amount of alcohol necessary for intoxication. Congress has the authority, but it is no reflection upon congressmen to admit that they lack both the special training and the expert judgment to decide many of the important issues before them. The one device which characterizes our modern world is scientific research. Every great business uses research. No great business could survive without it. Congress, however, tries to substantiate the old-fashioned methods of earlier days. It cannot be successfully accomplished in this modern world. Delay, interruption, irrelevant comment obstruct the conduct of business. Lacking any agreed body of facts, there is no common mind. Clashing personalities have to be subdued. Divergent interests must be reconciled. A long time is required before even the wrong course of action can be agreed upon. Congress needs surrender none of its privileges and rights in making use of the technical resources of this age to expedite its business. No congressman would lose anything in dignity and power by having at his disposal a competent digest of the significant facts and principles concerning the matters upon which he must vote and may speak. Think of the years which might have been saved had Congress, through a committee or otherwise, employed well-trained technicians to assemble all the facts concerning the possible measures of farm relief. This, surely, was no task for jacks of all trades. Action on any matter of national importance can be quickened and made more useful by the simple device of research. The Congress, which first learns to adapt its procedure to the spirit of these times by utilizing the research method of impartial inquiry, will be something new in the world. It will be acclaimed everywhere by a grateful people.